40 film credits. He's known for his roles in six-time Oscar nominee Captain Phillips, The A-Team with Liam Neeson, John Sayles' Amigo. I'd love to hear about that. Steven Soderbergh's two-part epic Che, The Tape, American Gangster, Music Within, War of the Worlds, Bad Boys 2.
That's a home video.
Yeah. Exactly. The Runaway Bride. He's a founding member of the Latin Theater Company and served two terms as co-artistic director with Steve Abbey-Girgis and Amy O'Donnell. He starred on Broadway in the Tony-nominated Motherfuckers of the Hat, opposite Chris Rock, and for his portrayal of the eccentric cousin Julio, he received nominations for a Drama Desk Award, an Outer Critics Circle Award, and a Tony Award for Best Featured Actor in a Play. Additional theater credits include The Last Days of Judas Iscariot at the Public Theater, opposite Sam Rockwell, directed by Philip Seymour Hoffman, Terrence McNally's Stendhal, Song Syndrome, the primary stages with Isabella Rossellini and Richard Thomas, and the Floating Island play that Mark did before. So, you did some work.
Thanks to you. She's at a Comic-Con in Calgary.
Yeah. I'm knowing why.
My wife is the voice of Princess Jasmine. which is kind of, it's crazy. It's why I've been doing it probably 25 years. And anytime you hear that voice, that's my wife's voice, right? If you go to Disney on Ice, the Princess who skates, the voices are the character voices. So she's been doing that for a long time, and now she's in Calgary. Or making it rain.
And we also are live on Facebook, so hello to the Facebook.
I'm seeing the talk, and I went, "Did you just fly in?" And she said, "No, suits are good for my activities." And I was like, "Fuck!" I've seen the terror of the wrong thing, or not working, or And I was like, "Wow." And the joy. When it does work. There can be great joy. But I was like, this is an enormous suitcase full of eggs. I was like, this is incredible. I'd like to see that into it. I'm really happy to be here. I hope I can answer or be a Yeah, I mean, it's very simple for me because it's the only thing I've ever known. I didn't have any other acting system or teacher. You know, when I met Terry, it was at a studio that I happened to land in. I, by the grace of God, fell into good hands. But I was a guy who was in a band, played in a band for many, many years. I had very long hair. I'm a guitar player. And I had acted as a child, but never really wanted to be an actor. I wanted to be a fucking rock star. So when I land in this studio, which is a whole other story that's way too long to get into, but I had never been in an acting class. And I dove into this, and it was something that worked for me really, really well, and I began to feel happier or more fulfilled as an artist than I had ever had in a band. And that was an amazing thing. Stuff was coming up that I didn't even know existed. So it's an incredible program. It's an incredible program, you know, and it's incredible training. You get it, obviously. You're all lucky you're here. You get it at the right place. But I remember meeting, there was other people in class that would study somewhere else, and they had 14 teachers and this and that, and I never understood any of that. I only knew one thing, and the simplicity of that worked for me very, very well.
That's great.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm assuming you make use of it still now when you get a job.
When I worked with charities, here's the thing, is like when you go into the actual, you know, world of this, you very few people will be able to speak to you the way that Terry can speak to you, you know, which is, it's unfortunate, you know, because directors should be able to, they should be able to speak to you well, but you know, sometimes they don't, they either don't know, you know what I mean, but the language of this and the tools that I learned, I apply, you know, all the time at work. And the most important, particularly for screen acting, is listening, you know. And the best compliment I can ever get from a director, like, you know, you're a great listener, so you know, like, that's really the whole thing.
Hi, yo, my name's Guy, I'm in Terry's second class. Let's dive right in. We're about to finish, and I actually come from music like you. And I know that in music and in many other arts, probably when you start out, you try to emulate the people you admire or inspired by, and then it's very, I feel, hard to just trust with what you have. How to bring yourself, your special, take a gamble on that. So I'd love to hear about your process for that.
If I understand the question correctly, is that you're saying that you find it hard for yourself to trust yourself when you're working on character?
Yeah, I think it's much easier to try to emulate stuff that you saw outside,
right,
than to trust that maybe you can bring something totally new and fresh to this.
Right. Well, I think when you begin, I think it's a great thing to have a clear idea of the kind of career that you want to have, because when I was a very young guitar player, there were guitar players that I was like, that's interesting to me. I want to shoot for that. This other stuff doesn't interest me. And then you have a clear, then you've charted a clear course to something that speaks to you, and it's the same with acting. So you watch performances, you know, and you, I will tell you right now, steal it the fuck all. Because here's, at the end of the day, it's gonna come through you. So it's going to come out. It's going to go into you, and it's going to come out different because it's going to go through your filter. And as you can, if you continue to do that, you'll come to the day where it'll just be you. You know what I mean? Like, and that is where the really cool shit happens, is when the human is coming through, because that's what everyone in here or anyone else can bring to something that is unique. You know what I mean? As opposed to trying to do, copy some other thing. You know what I mean? Which, so I'm telling you to steal it. I'm telling you don't copy. But you pinch stuff. You know, I mean, you I'm sure you guys talk about that. Right? You pinch, watch performances, and you take.
You steal it. You just have to add a little of you in.
Yeah.
It's gotta. Can't just do a carbon copy.
No. You can't. No. You can't like. You can't do a, like an impersonation, but you can take stuff from other people because everybody does that. You know, all the people that you admire have done that. You know.
Yeah.
Hope that helps.
Yeah. Well, Darren. Hi, I'm Darren. Hey, I'm with Terry, second class. I was actually just telling him how in class the other day, the most recent thing I saw you was the Infiltrator.
Yeah.
And I wanted like a standout. You were really to stand out. I'm not just saying that because you're here. I just thought it was like such a great character and something that like I took and just remembered
when
I filmed.
Why did you like? Because he's very fussy. This guy. What's that?
Thinking of fussy?
In a good way. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I mean he doesn't just like everybody.
Yeah, there was something just about it. Did have an element of this kind of rock star quality, and that's kind of my question. But there was this, there was like a true, real character idea, and you could see everyone's relationship, with each different actor in each different situation. It was just like the body language, just the full package of a true character. And,
yeah.
And another thing I liked was that it was you didn't speak that much, really. If I recall, there was very little dialogue.
Very economic.
Exactly. So it was the moments, the silence, the looks, and what you did say that was really, it was really awesome. I recommend it to everyone.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, no, of course. But actually, we're kind of a little off topic. I was just curious, just because I also come from a musical background and household, and I was just really interested and curious about how your history as a musician might affect, or if it plays a big part in your acting life, whether it be maybe songs or particularizations or a point of view or just like character ideas. I'm just really curious to hear about if that does kind of still have that residual you being a musician. I'm sure you still play, but I'm just curious about that.
Absolutely, because I think I'm a self-taught guitar player, so I play by ear.
Mm.
So, back in the day when we had records,
I
had to slow them down, see what the guy was playing, figure out if he was playing, or that's how I learned how to play. So that trains your ear. So for me, I think that helped me with dialects and absorb, listening, being able to sort of do the dialect, you know what I mean? So I think my ear, because it's a musical, I have a musical ear, helped me with that. I also think it helps you to understand time. If you're playing a band, you have to play in time. Sometimes time is very important, especially in comedy. So I think, I think that all helped me. And having had a performing background, having coming from another discipline, I understood that you had to woodshop. You had to woodshed. You had to because I would play guitar incessantly. I still do it. I lay on the couch watching TV, and there's a guitar on my lap, and I'm playing guitar. It makes my wife insane. it's constant working on it. So I think I understood the benefit of that when I came into acting.
All right, thank you.
Yes.
Good afternoon. Yo, we're going to be talking, I am not in your class, but
why not?
I came here so that we can talk about that.
Tell me your name,
Kareem.
Kareem.
Yes. I just want to say kudos to you for being a trailblazer. As a Latino, I look up to figures like you and another brother that's in here, but whatever, I won't mention his name. But nonetheless, you know, I've been in the business for a very long time. Like you, when I was younger, I started, and you know, I've managed to book some great things, I've worked with some amazing people. But at the same time, there's also these things that, you know, as an actor you go through, especially when you're Latino, when you're not Latino enough, or you're not this enough, or you know. And then with agencies, you know, you try to stick to the same agencies. This is a loaded question, so I'm sorry, but for the most part, it's a nuanced sense that exists. You know, when they pigeonhole you and they tell you, you know, you can only be either the cop or the robber. And then after that, then I don't know. And then it's ambiguous when they have a breakdown. So, you know, I guess just holding on and fighting through that. And then how do you kind of escape those characterizations of you? And like maybe like stay the course. And as far as representation is concerned, you know, and they're like, oh, we'll submit you for these 3 liners, 4 liners, but you're beyond that. So when do you like draw that line and just like try to move forward and you know, portray yourself as something else other than the cop or the robber? Because, you know, I can also be the attorney. Yeah,
sure.
I mean, it's small.
Of course. So you're asking, well, so okay, so as far as your ages. As far as like saying no, I'm not gonna refer to like a 3-line part. That's, if you feel strongly about that, then sometimes that's the fucking answer, is no. And you have to be okay with not getting the part. Say 3 lines, you can look at his reel and offer him the part. You know, personally, the director can't watch for reel. I don't know if you can do this 3 lines. Maybe it shouldn't be direct and think, but that's a different conversation. That's not the actual world that we live in. You mean? So I understand your question is valid. You have to decide for you, man, when you said, I've done enough things that I think, respectfully, I'm beyond coming to read for you for 3 lines. You know what I mean? And it's, but that will come from you in a discussion that you have with your reps, you know. That's a, you know, yeah, nobody should, you know, if you don't feel that, then you shouldn't do it. What was the other part of your question?
That was so much better.
As far as Latino.
Oh, really? Yeah. Okay, I love playing drug dealers. Because they're fun as fuck. The thing is, I would encourage you not to look at it as, oh, this is a drug dealer. Look at it, how well written is this? Can you score in it? You know, there's people like, can I take this and score in this part? And if you can, and well, it's written enough, and you're in good hands, in the hands of a good director, or, you know, those are reasons to maybe do it. You know what I mean? And I love playing villains. So I played the attorney as well, and I played the other thing, but those are fun. I mean, they're fun and they're delicious parts.
I agree.
You know, and so I don't really have, it's weird, you know? I try to go by the part, you know what I mean? Who's involved, you know? Because if you play a drug dealer in the wrong hands, then it could be a disaster.
So in other words, just ride the wave and try to just make it as best as possible.
Ride the wave, work, keep working, and you'll see, people will begin to see you differently.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Because they'll be forced to, you know?
Thank you.
Yeah. Hey, my name is Sebastian Prandoni. I'll be starting school in the fall. And I had a question. I'm sure you get a lot of parts and offers, and you get to decide. And when you decide on a particular part, and let's say you start filming in 2 months or 3 months, whatever it might be, that time period, how do you prepare yourself? What's your process in that time span, however much time you're allotted, once you're given the script and the part and everything?
His phone rings. I mean, I wish I had sometimes 2 months or 3 months to prepare for a project. The truth is sometimes I have had that kind of time. Sometimes I haven't. You know, I jumped into a movie, somebody dropped out of a film, where I had to speak four fucking languages in.
Oh, wow.
And 2 weeks to prepare for this movie. So, you know, you just, I don't know, you dive in. I mean, you just, like, you know, you roll up your sleeves and you get to work. I mean, and whatever time you have is never going to be enough time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You know, but it's very rare, like, the situation where you're like, you know, Daniel Day-Lewis has been living as Lincoln for 5 years. I mean, that's Daniel Day-Lewis' world, man.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not my world. You know what I mean? Like, you know, my world is you know, usually it goes in a week.
Especially
television. You can prepare for a television show, and you'll get 14 rewrites the day that you know. There's a guy back there that's been on a TV show for a long time, he can tell you. I mean, you know, you get your pages all the fucking time. You know, so you just do the best you can, you know, with whatever time you have, you know.
Okay.
But I can tell you, it'll never be enough time. They're not that big. They're tiny ones, but they're consistent, and they chip away at you. You know what I mean? And it's like, it's something, it's a slight from somebody, something they didn't say, or something they said. And it's usually never so much that, like, you slipped on a banana peel and the whole tray of drinks came on top of it. It's much smaller than that. But it still bites. You know what I mean? But I remember a situation one time where I was making this film and had this idea that I thought was really good. And I went to this director, you know, and I said, "Hey, man, I have this idea for the scene." And he's like, "Oh, okay, yeah, okay, tell me." So I started talking. Let me talk for like 10 minutes, which is an eternity on like a film set. You know, 10 minutes, and then at the end of the 10 minutes, he goes, "Love that idea. When you make your movie, you will go to that." Stephen is a guy that I know since before he had ever written a play. So when we started Labyrinth, and Stephen came into Labyrinth, Stephen came in as an actor. And then he he wrote some stuff one day, you know, and it was really good, you know. And Phil said, "Man, this is really cool. Keep writing." And then he wrote a play, and then he kept writing plays. And Phil started directing Stephen's plays. Phil directed every one of Stephen's plays, with the exception of when his first play, up until Motherfucker with the Hat, which was directed by a woman called Anna Shapiro. So Phil was instrumental in many ways in shaping, you know, Stephen, you know, and they really worked well together. So because we were all there, we started reading Stephen's plays, and then he would start writing for people, you know, and he would see people's strengths, and he was like, you know, and then that's, we just sort of kept going on this journey, you know, with him. I've done a few of his plays. He's given me some of the greatest parts I've ever had. I mean, the part in Judas Iscariot, to me, my favorite one of his plays, is incredible, you know. You know, it's great to work with young playwrights or to like hook up with them and like grow with them, you know what I mean, and like be part of their sort of process. Because there's a thing that happens with a young playwright and a young actor and they come up together, you know, and writing for, you know, using each other's strengths, you know what I mean, or you become an actor who is a great interpreter of someone's writing. You know, you understand their work. So, I don't know if this answers your question.
Yeah.
So my name is John. I'm a first year in Mary's classes. Sort of to piggyback off of that, I'm really interested in how the relationship between theater acting and film acting, but also the community of that. You know, like the names you're mentioning are sort of like, they become your friends, not only people that you work with. And so I wonder what value community has for you, and do you still like go see shows, and do you like take your friends with you, and what is it like to be on a film set and then, you know, be rehearsing a play the next week or going back and forth? Like, do you, does it feel different? Are you like, I'm a film actor and then I'm a theater actor here, or is it just all sort of the same scramble that
I mean, I think, you know, we were taught that, you know, acting is acting. I mean, there are technical, you know, adjustments that you would make for a film acting or for acting a TV show, you know, as opposed to being on stage, and also on the house you're in. But I don't approach it any differently. I don't go, oh, I'm doing this play, that's why I have to act differently. You know what I mean? I also don't believe that you need to do a lot on stage. You know, I believe in stillness, so I don't know. I never separate, I never did that, oh, this is film acting. I thought that was always a, right? It's a tricky thing to say, I'm going to do stillness and film acting.
Because I think people nowadays get scared about money and keep your money over their hand. I mean, there's still these people who say, I want to be in the theater and I love doing that.
Yeah.
It's also kind of hard to make a living when you're doing an off Broadway show, you can do commercials and stuff like that. That
Yes.
For it. But I think more people than not who tend to train nowadays both want the power in the media. But I was thinking about what Sam would think about it, and you know too, that Sam likes to do a play at least once a year if he can, because it keeps you honest.
Oh yeah. Did I misunderstand your question?
No, it was sort of like a two-part type.
Oh,
so it was like that.
Oh, the community.
But then also the community element of like being part of the theater scene and always being working on like a play, as opposed to just like a film or TV show that you sort of get like a guest spot in, and then you
Yeah, and then you that, well, sure. I mean, doing a play, you're gonna spend a lot more time with those people.
Yeah.
But only just because of the nature of, you know, rehearsing a play and then, you know, writing a play. But you know, I was fortunate that I landed at this this theater company and performed this thing, and it just kind of took off. I wish I could tell you that there was some formula, but you know, we didn't know. It was a ragtag bunch of people. They gave us a theater space on 52nd Street with rats and like no heating. Like, we painted it and started doing theater games, you know, and that became Labyrinth. That's so that was my community in many ways. I mean, there was a support group there, you know, but. You know, and then you build a support group and climb, you know, like my best friend is a guy I met in when I went to study, when I first met Terry. Well, you know, that guy's been in my life for many years. So I think, you know, that's, you just build it, you know?
Because you see each other so intimately in class, or much more than the show.
And you usually will know quickly. Right. I'm a TV show, immediately like, I'm never going to talk to him. You know, but yeah, but he's right though. It's, you know, and you don't have to be friends with everybody that you work with. I mean, that's just not actually possible. But, sometimes your friend card is full. I got to get rid of a friend before you give another one in. So, you know, but.
I'm Kaylee, I'm first year. So I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about your training in the early years, if there's anything you remember coming up against a wall or against your edge, as Terry says, and also during the years that you started working, if you had any creative walls that you hit and like how you got around that or worked through that.
So. Oh, so long since I was in my first year. You know, I think the thing for me was trusting myself, and that I was, you know, that I was enough. You know what I mean? Like, it didn't have to guilt a little. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, you are enough, you know what I mean, in a situation that would be interesting to watch as opposed to trying to do something, you know what I mean?
You also had a great class.
Yeah, we had a crazy class.
The power of saying, really great class.
Yeah, we did. We had, it was a lot of powerhouses. Like, there was this woman, Paola, who was fierce, man, like tough. And we would do these exercises and we'd switch into Spanish, you know, both, you know, spoke to us. So like, we'd be like, Sam, be like, wow, that's crazy when you guys started switch to Spanish. I'm like, yeah, I don't know, we just started, you know, speaking Spanish. But a wall creatively at work, you know, I think it'd be amazing if one was challenged more at work. You know, like, I think, so because some of the material that you get is not going to be as good as the place you, the material you're working on it, you know, I mean, it's not possible. So, sometimes work is really about staying loose, really loose, and open to the environment, like, of where you are, letting that inform, and just listening to the other person, you know, and that's, letting all the distractions kind of fall away. That, in many ways, becomes the hardest part of the job sometimes on a movie or a TV show. You know, stage is different because once that thing starts, if you get the train off on the road correctly, you know.
If you don't, you get to do it again tomorrow night.
That's right. That's right. That's a good news.
training process when you're like learning so much about yourself constantly and you're opening up these like hidden pockets of your secret life and it's like, what do I do with this? And how do I make this into art rather than just get swallowed? I mean, you did answer my question, but I'm wondering, more about struggle and...
Well, I'm really glad that Terry said it because I wish I could tell you that goes away. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't, you know, and I don't care where you are on the ladder, they all have doubts and fears and insecurities.
Yeah. Right?
And that is like, that's part of the game. Right? And it's kind of good in a way.
It means you care.
Yeah, exactly. It means you care about doing something well. You know what I mean? But insecurity in our business is legion. I mean, it's an ocean of it. You know? I mean, a film set is an ocean of insecurity. Every department, the grip guys are like, dude, am I a good grip? In charge of this giant sort of machine, and I'm one tiny piece of this machine, you know. And I know that he's not gonna go, hey man, that was great. I mean, that's he sometimes be like, okay, we're moving on. You know what I mean? And you're like, which is, yeah. If I don't like it, I'll tell you. You know what I mean? So you need to like be confident, like, no, that was good. You know what I mean? That was good. You know what I mean? And you'll know, you know. And sometimes you don't think it was good, and you're not going to get a chance to do it again. He got what he needed, and that's it. You'll just have to, you know.
You'll think about it on the way home in the cab.
And you'll talk about it 2 years later, and you will. I mean, I've seen grown, great actor men crying about a day at work that they thought didn't go well, or somebody showed up with, you know, a little more fucking prepared. You know, the day that, you know, mm-hmm. that day. Really upset about something, you know. And we'll carry it. You'll carry it forever. He's like, oh, I could have done that. You know,
right.
That was 3 years ago, dude. Yeah. I know, but I could have done that. It's really interesting because the last days of Judas Iscariot, which Phil directed, I remember having a conversation with him years after we'd done it, and he said, you know, I was thinking the other day, I think I found a way to solve the ending. You know? I was like, it's crazy, you know? But that's amazing, you know? That's what you want, though, you know? That's the thing. You want to be doing that.
Yeah.
Always thinking how, what other crack is this? Can I get in on this, you know what I mean? Which is why I work with him, because we, you know, he sees things when I go, that I didn't see, you know, many things, you know, it's like, so you have a great collaborator, somebody who's like, what about this? And in this particular case, somebody who knows me and Sam and other people well, I mean, knows the lock to the combo. I mean, you know, the combination to the lock, so, you know, mm-hmm. I hope that helps.
Yeah, that was helpful, thank you.
Someone else?
We have a question on Facebook. Does Yul
have
a favorite piece of advice that someone gave you that still sticks with you?
Yeah. Piece of advice from a director I worked with early on, an incredible director. I said to him, you have any advice? He goes, here's my advice. Follow the part. I don't care if it's in the basement of a church. Mm-hmm. He's like, if it's a great part, do it. Like, that's, just do that. That's your advice? He's like, yeah. You know, and that's actually, it's good advice. You know, because you can't always hit, but if you follow certain things, you can hit. hedge your bets a little, and following the part, I think, is always a good idea. You know, there are, like Terry said earlier, sometimes, you know, financial, you know, considerations, and you have to, sometimes, I mean, the part's not so good, but, you know, you have to pay the mortgage. That's also bad, you know. Yeah, and that's real, you know, but and that person owes me $50.
I wanted to ask, I've always wanted to ask you, because I don't know that everyone knows this, but you actually didn't finish the Meisner training because you chose to do a big film.
Yeah, on my first job.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And I'm just wondering if you would do it the same way again. I think you obviously learned a lot on the job going forward because you kept going.
Yeah. I did, but I kept coming back and finishing.
Yes,
yeah, I piecemealed it, but
yes.
Much to Bill's chagrin.
Yeah. But he blessed you.
He did. He did. He.
It was a big part. It was an important part.
Well, man,
it was a big book at the time. Mamo King sing songs of love by Oscar.
Yeah, and won the Pulitzer, and I got a part in the movie, and it's a nothing part, but I was like. I also had no money. I mean, I was trying to pay for acting class, and it's like, and I had really long hair. This was my first job. My hair did hair down to here. Like, they cut all this movie takes place in the 50s. But I got this job, and it was like 3 months in LA. You know, I was like, I'm going to LA. And I remember Bill, when I told him, he said, come to my office.
It was the beginning of second year? Or
no, beginning of first year.
Oh, really?
6 months into first year. It was crazy, dude. But he laid into me. He said, well, you don't know about acting, I could write fucking volumes with. Basically, what do you think you are? You're going to go to this movie. And then he went, good luck. Yeah. And he goes, you know, but yeah. It's like, this is really, you know, Bill helped me make a critical decision in my life. When I started the program, I did the summer program. And like I told you, I had long hair, and I was playing in a band, and I was in a band that was on Epic Records, and we had just been dropped by Epic Records, meaning we had no record deal. That's back when there was a record business. literally, we were like, trying to get another deal.
This was Diving for Pearls.
It was a band called Diving for Pearls. And this was 1991, somewhere. And we were like, I was like, what am I, you know, my life suddenly was like crazy, you know, I don't know what's gonna happen, you know. And the singer in the band's girlfriend knew somebody in Esper's, you know, and we talked about acting, and she's like, you know, why don't you take this acting class? And I'm like, man, yeah, it sounds cool, I'm gonna do it. So I started the summer program, in the summer program, I had to make a decision. I said to Bill, I said, look, what do you want? I'm a guy from a band, you know what I mean? Like, should I be an actor? He's like, he looked at me and goes, I can't make a decision for you, but if you're asking me if I think that you have talent for this, my answer is yes, but you have to make your own decision. Okay. And this was what, like, and quit the band. And I haven't been in a band since. And then I got Mongo King's Sixth of Davis, and then kept coming back and finished the program. I think it's unbelievably important to finish the program. And I often wondered what it had been like if I had just done the program straight through. Yeah. But I didn't, but I've always stayed very close to the program because of my relationships with people that I met in it, you know.
Hi, my name is Lucia. I'm a second year at Jerry's, obviously. I was wondering, this is kind of piggybacking off of Haley's question, but is there anything that you find challenging to this day when you receive a script, something that you, like, you know, maybe it's coming up with a character idea or getting emotionally connected to a certain topic or anything like that, and how you kind of overcome it. Or, I mean, I know you have Terry, but if there's something that's like you can share with us.
Yeah, you know, I mean, sometimes the instincts fire, you know, and then sometimes they know that you have to just sort of go to work on it technically, you know, but yeah, that happens all, it happens a lot, you know, it happens a lot, I think, particularly because there's no, you know, if you're doing a play, then you have the processing, you have time to explore stuff, but in films and in television, you know, it gets stale quickly, so there's an issue with the writing, and you try and get it, like, wrap your mouth, you know, wrap your head around it, figure it out, have the words sit well with you, and it's not, and you have to just, you know, that, those are problems that, like, okay, I gotta figure this out quickly, you know, and then you can improvise a little bit. But that happens a lot. Initially, the thing for me is that the first thing that happens is terror. I have this part, terror. it's crazy because one loves to act, but if you have respect for something, there's a little element of fear. You know what I mean? And you fear that you might not do it well. You know what I mean? But you got to dive in. You know what I mean? And figure it out and do it to the fullest of your ability. You know.
Another question from the Facebook. I'm guessing this person's a Bloodline fan. His name's Jonathan. He's asking whether you're in Bloodline Season 3 and what your thoughts are on the character that you play in Bloodline.
Well, it's another villain. Am I in Season 3? I can't, well...
I don't know if you're allowed to discuss that.
I am in Season 3, but... and that's actually, it's a lot... The show's over, actually, so it's... I mean, I think, but all the fans know, I don't, you know. I like the character. Again, it's a very odd and mysterious dude, you know. Does a lot of weird stuff. You know, he's kind of just a really laid back, bad man. but I've had fun doing that character because we dressed him in a preppy way. Like, we went against the whole villain thing. He's dressed like maybe some dude who went to Brown or something. I don't even know what that means, but. Schools were fancy people go to. I mean, I did high school and that was it. And I come, you know, my father was a surgeon, so very educated people, and his brother was as well. But that was never a road that interested me, because since I was five, all I wanted to do was make stuff. So, you know, and my interest, and I'm going off topic, but I think it's helpful. My interest to really varied, because I love photography. I spend a lot of time taking pictures. I make music. I draw. You know, I paint. It's like it all feeds. Like, it keeps me sane during. It keeps me sane. Like, in between stuff. You know, you want to stay creative. You want to create every day. You know, even if it's for 15 minutes. You know, do something. You know.
My name is Arlena, so I'm in Terry's first year class. I'm actually happy you spoke about your father. I was going to ask, when you decided you were going to become an actor,
yeah,
how was it, like, bringing it to your family?
Well, my mother was an actress. My mother was an actress. I didn't want to be an actor, but they threw me... Have a seat. they want to stand for this. It's not that important.
Okay. They don't know.
They don't know that you're taking acting class.
And no. I don't want to tell them.
Okay.
That's not the first time that's happened.
Yeah. I wish I knew what to tell you, but I had a mother that encouraged me, like bought me a drum set when I was 7. Can you just imagine a 7-year-old with a drum kit in the apartment? Okay, that's insane. So, you know, and I grew up in Miami with my mother, and my mother was an actress, and I was never forced to do anything that I didn't want to do. What she would say to me was, be as good as you can at it, you know what I mean? So I've been in the arts since I can remember, and when my mother came from Cuba, she joined a theater company that was comprised of exiled Cuban actors in Miami. And whenever there was a kid, that was the default kid, so I was thrilled. So I had acted as a little kid, but I wanted to be a rock star. So how do you tell your parents? I mean, I think you have to say, this is, you know, if you have a burning desire to do it, who could deny you that? I mean, you know what I'm saying? And do your parents like doctors and lawyers?
No, my parents are really good, straight, think that you need a 9-to-5 and you need to become a police or a nurse or a doctor, and that's life, and that's
yeah.
That.
Yeah, but
there's no way in arts that you have no possibility.
That's because they're scared.
Yeah, definitely.
That's because they
want
to make sure when they're gone, they're going to eat.
No, yeah, definitely. That's
exactly right.
Yeah.
But what he said is important, because I'm assuming also, since you have a lot of love in your heart, from what I can tell, that you got some of that from them.
Yeah.
And even that fear has some love in it. And so if they love you, and you have to say, you'll say, I have a burning desire, Mama, this is what makes me happy.
Yeah.
And I don't want you to worry, because I'm going to do it. And I want you in the front row when I do my first play. And you come from that, that'll be hard. It'll help them. Hopefully.
Yeah. Show them that you are working hard at it. That this is, you know, I think there's folks out there that still don't look at this as an actual job, you know, which is amazing. But you will encounter those people.
Or art.
Yeah, or art, exactly. Or art. Yeah. Or so, but you know, but you seem like driven to me. So
I really am. So what I decided.
Yeah. You get pushy in the work.
And I decided was I'll either invite Mom to graduation when I graduate, or she'll call me when she sees me on the big screen.
There you go. You know.
That's what I decided.
I think they're gonna support you. I mean, I couldn't imagine that they would. Like Terry said, what are they gonna do?
Yeah.
You know.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Lau. Terry's first year. I was just curious, what kind of habits have you instilled that help to pave the way for success? Like, so for some people, they'll wake up at like 5:30 a.m. and work out, or they'll meditate, they'll journal, they have their vocal warm-ups. And it doesn't necessarily have to be like a physical action, it could just even be like a certain mindset or a way of thinking that's kind of just helped you, whether it's in the work or both in your personal life as well.
That's a really great question. I do some TM, which helps me, you know. I'm interested in certain spiritual things that are things that comfort me. I don't get up at 5:30 and go to the gym. In fact, I'm like a night person. I'm really more, you know, I'm more alive at 3 a.m. than, you know. I mean, that's just, that also probably comes from playing in cover bands, you know, playing bars till 5 o'clock, you know, when I was, you know, guitar player. But I mean, I don't have any particular, you know, regimen that I follow. I do, like I said, I do meditate, and just try and stay physically fit and healthy, and you know, as sane as you can, because you know, because all the other side of it is so not sane. You know, a lot comes at you. So if you go like, if you don't let all that stuff rattle you, which I think meditation helps with that. At least you can help. It helps me. I hope that's helpful. I'm sorry.
I mean, everyone has their own ways. So
yeah. There's vocal warm ups that I, you know, if I'm doing a play, you know, I'll do those sometimes, you know. I know it's not. This is not what you want to hear. Somebody's like, don't say that. Depending on how strenuous the vocal. Warm-ups are great, you know. Sleep is actually great. Sleep is great. So I try to sleep a lot. It's good, yeah. I mean, it really is, you know. Try and stay centered.
I'm just starting out in auditioning and trying to build a reel and all of that. Do you have any advice for when I'm on set, just starting out, just getting there, like kind of, what was your experience with your first on set experience and how you kind of handled it or what you did or what the experience was like for you? Just because I'm just starting to get into that right now.
Have you worked on it?
I just shot like a student film, and then next weekend I'm doing another kind of like a student indie short type of thing. So this is my first time on a set,
yeah.
But not like a real, not like with your movie that you did on while you were
all those people
school.
Are going to be on real sets.
Yeah. So I'm wondering like how to connect yourself, or if you have a what is like for you just an experience of.
Yeah. My first job, which I told you about, I really was trying to be so incredibly helpful, you know what I mean, and I was so damn eager, you know, to please everybody, I don't want to advise you to do that.
Yeah.
So I'm telling you like what for me it was like, and then I realized that really cared, you know what I mean, it's like. And you want to be liked, and you want people to go, oh, man, you're good, and you want to let that happen, and it might happen, or they may say it, or they may not say it. The best advice that I can give you is to stay true to you and what you're doing, work your actions, be prepared, know your lines, and stay loose and really present, you know what I mean, and try to interpret whatever direction you're getting into a language. Sometimes you can translate it to a language that'll work for you. You know?
Don't be a jerk.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, never. No. Never, ever do that. Because, and look, like I said, I'm not the Daniel Day-Lewis guys. That's not my world. I'm like the journeyman. I'm like about the long game, you know what I mean? And if you're a jerk, that will spread like wildfire. Or if you're late to work, the fucking assistant to the crash fucking service guy's cousin will know that you were late. Be professional, be on time, do your thing, that, you know, and you'll be fine. You'll be more than fine, because you'll encounter many that are not doing that, that are late, or like fighting with people, screaming, you know, it's crazy stuff. So, yeah, you know. Hope that helps.
Yeah.
Henry.
Hi, Yul. My name is Henry. I'm finishing up my first year with Terry. And I wanted to ask you about character, which is something we actually don't get into it until our second year, so I'm sort of uncharted territory, but I just wanted to know, you know, you play a character and you sort of infuse yourself into the character and you put yourself as the filter, but I was wondering if you've ever played characters and then coming out of playing them, you've taken a piece of that character and stayed with you rather than the other way around, and you sort of have a, you know, whether it's a mannerism or, you know, personality trait, something that you've taken and taken from that character and it stayed with you before, and whether or not that's, you know, positive or negative for you.
Well, it stayed with you in that you applied it to something else or applied it to your personal life.
Or yeah, in your personal life, it's just something that's like stuck with you, and you know, in, even when you're alone, like your most inner self.
That's a really interesting. That's a wild question. I don't know. I mean, I don't think so. No. I usually, you know, once you're done with it, you know. I mean, unless I didn't notice it, you mean, but it's fact. So something that you worked on has stayed with you, like a physicality of this character.
You do it in the mirror because you like it so much afterwards.
Yeah. Yeah. Some of that. No, that's kind of wild, man. I don't think that's happened to me. But you know.
What about when you're doing a play? Because I know. You're doing a movie that you have a big part in, so it's a longer shoot, and it's a dark part. I know some actors feel like it's hard to shake that length, but they need to shake it up a little bit, because you know, if you're a serial killer, you come home and you're not as jolly.
Well, I think I think one of the best things to do is to go polar opposite. You're done. You mean go like
bowling?
Yeah, exactly. Well, like kind of like like do something really different than what how you're behaving during the day at work. You know what I mean? But I really, you know, we can get into a tricky area here because you know, like again, like you know, Daniel Day-Lewis living as Lincoln for you know. I worked with somebody who worked on that movie, and you know he would come into the makeup trailer and sit down and start, talking to her as if he was actually fucking Lincoln. She was like, I didn't know what to do. Put the guy's thing on, you know, the hair. He's like, you know, did you read about it? She's like, I didn't know what to say to him. You know, like these topics that Lincoln, that he had read, that I guess Lincoln spoke about, you know, and so, bless you. That's a little, I don't know. Again, this is a tricky area. That is not, I don't think it necessarily worked like that. Maybe it works for him.
Yeah.
I like things that, you know, like I love Christopher Walken. Christopher Walken will kill 7 guys, you know, with a knife, and then cut. He goes, "Hey, did you hear about that cat? That you know."
it's not,
and you believe him murdering 7 guys in a corner, but he's like, cut. He's like telling you a joke. I mean, and there's a lot of there's a lot of guys that you respect that if I named them that are exactly like that.
Right.
They're it's interesting. They can turn that on. You know, that's what comes with time. But, you know, it's like when you get you finished your 2 years and you have your toolkit, start using those tools, then you can turn certain things on and off. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it's very interesting that this behavior has stayed with you.
I'm careful. My name is Daniel, and I'm in Terry's first year. I've had a prior career and pursuing a lifelong dream. I guess I want to ask you, when you get a new role, which is, like, if you were to take a sort of an intellectual process where you would read, reread, and immerse yourself in the script, maybe writing down what you say about yourself, what every other person says about you, time, place, events, versus the rehearsal process where you're just doing maybe even exercises to take it to extremes, to find moments. Can you talk about the balancing between sort of your personal study of the script versus the rehearsal and just doing process? Which is more important, or is it a combination? Just to address that.
You mean during a play?
Or approaching a television movie or a play, or ahead of time, during the rehearsal process.
There's not a lot of rehearsal in a movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I get that. Well, then, in a play.
It's a big luxury in a movie to get to rehearse. In a play, you know, I don't read it, I'll read it. Like, if you're going to do a play, you've read the play. Then you go the first day and you're going to read it a lot. You know what I mean? Right. So I don't really read things a lot. If I'm going to go do a
film. I think he's asking about, like maybe you have a journal or like you have something you are writing down for what you want to do.
Oh.
Internal study of my character
stuff.
Right?
Oh, sorry. And the director says, okay, everybody, we're going to be Italian. And then, like, how do you sort of switch back and forth between what's being offered and invited in the rehearsal process versus what you're doing on your own? How those two manuscripts?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so my own personal, my own personal work, I generally don't, you don't have to always share that with the director. You know what I mean? It's like, that's your thing, you know? You might say, like, wait, I've been working on this, and be like, no, don't, you know, but that's working for you, you know what I mean? But then, you know, your language that's happening internally with you is yours. Mm-hmm. And if it's working, and they're not saying anything, then it doesn't matter what you think. You could be thinking about a rhinoceros, or what, I don't know. But that's working for you, that's a chord that hits you, you know what I mean? And that makes you, you know, fly, then. Sometimes if you tell them that, they're like, no, don't think of rhinoceros. Why are you doing that? I'm like, you know, they're like, no, it's a flamingo. You know what I mean? I'm like, but no, for you, that works. So I don't know. I don't really, I don't share a lot of my internal process with them. And people generally will not ask you, you know what I mean? They might want to suggest something to you, which is great. But, you know, I don't know. Yeah. So I hope that's helpful. Yeah.
Thank you.
I feel like I failed miserably. Helping them.
What advice would you have for a hypothetical, to handle a hypothetical terrible director? If you could give a vignette that doesn't name names, and how you work with that, preserve yourself.
Said that so many times. I've said that to actors. I said, I went to study at a place that the entire point was to make me director proof. So when you came up in front of a clown like this guy right here, you know, not, you know, the director, you know, can't. No, because I went like this. I'll
have this Facebook.
Some idiot that doesn't, you know,
some water.
That's terrible. You need to, you know, you gotta.
Can you tell a story without naming the project or the name? Budget a little bit if you need to, just to tell us what you did to handle it, what was awful, and what you did.
I had a situation recently where I was shooting something. I had to come in the room and say all this stuff. And I was working with this guy, and we did it like five times. And he comes to me and goes, "Hey, is there a version of this where you where you're maybe like really angry or something?" And I said, okay, well, let's see. Let's try it. So I tried it. And then he came back and he said, "Is there a version of this?" Which those were the exact words. "A version of this where..." And I said, "No, there isn't." I said, no, there isn't. There isn't. And I was like, there was something to say. He was like, "Is there a version of this?" I'm like, "Is there a version of this is not..." But you know, Terry is Terry's right, because the reality is that most of the people that you will encounter will not actually be able to speak to you, like, in a language.
And you got to translate.
And you must translate it. And you must translate it quickly. You know what I mean? And most of the time, what I learned really a long time ago is I don't ask these guys anything. I go and I do the thing. And if they want to change it, then they come to me. But I'm not going to ask them, because the minute I ask them, they think I don't know the answer. Mm-hmm. They're like, oh, he's unsure.
I'm like, and they have so much to worry about. They're so happy if you know what you're doing, and that just makes them work.
Thrilled. They're thrilled that you know what you know. Yeah, they're like, yeah, because they have a lot of stuff to worry about.
Worry about lighting and weather and all kinds of things.
Yeah. Time, you know, people breathing down their necks. Yeah, you know, there's never enough time to share anything, but, you know. I hope that helps.
Okay, what, just talking about Bloodlines, how many, did you have different directors for different episodes?
You have, yes. Sometimes you'll have, they will block shoot, which means they'll shoot two episodes simultaneously, you know, because of location, so you might have, one director will do two.
Or the series we worked on where you play the minister with the pet mortuary.
Yeah, that's coming on in July, yeah.
So did you have different directors for different episodes with that?
Yeah, we had a guy who directed the pilot, who's a Danish guy. And then we had different directors for every episode, except we had one director who did two. But he was also one of the producers. Yes.
So what's it like to have a part that's consistent and have different directors coming in when you're working on a series? Because that happens a lot.
Sure, yeah. Well, they come into your flow. You know, because this machine is already going. It's like, you shoot the pilot, the powers that be have decided, okay, this is the pilot, this is the look, this is how we want it to be like, and then everybody that comes in.
Tell them the name of that show.
It's called Midnight Texas. It's a supernatural show. It's going to start in July. And it looks very well shot, and I think it came out actually quite nice. But the directors coming into you know, TV shows have to come into the flow of the show, especially a show that's been running for years and years and years. You know, that machine is already, it knows what it is, you know. And directors, most of the time, are guys that are just going to move the camera. They're not going to give you any acting notes, really. Just not really. It's just
thank God.
Yeah, thank God, really. Yeah, sure. Because a lot of them would know, you know. But there's more and more, you know. And as the technology, which I'm a huge fan of the tech as a tech, which is it's just exploding. What you can shoot a film out with is mind-bending. So you have a lot of people that are amazingly, amazing shooters. They can make something look stunning visually, but couldn't help you. If you got in trouble and said, well, what about this? They wouldn't know what to say to you because it's not their thing. You know, I think guys like that are, there's not a lot of them left, really, unfortunately. You know, I mean, it's kind of like a weird. You know, it used to be the other, you know, they were, yeah, that's what you had. We just talked about the man in the car. Yeah, you had people like that who were like, you know, Kubrick, who could visually, you know, shoot a film and had such a clear vision of the movie. Like, he'd seen the movie so much that he knew exactly where, you know, and I actually love those guys. I mean, it's been like, it's so limiting, but like, man, if you're so clear on how you, on the idea of the vision of this film, you know, that you can, you know, I'll take the journey with you, really, because.
So talk about John Sayles. I was going to ask you about that, because he's a hero of mine. And I don't know that too many people know him, but he's
they're so young, you know. Yeah. I mean, John Sayles is considered, you know, the father of independent cinema, really, in many ways. I mean, he was a maverick auteur who directed some incredible films with incredible actors that I would encourage you to go look at his movies.
That's him.
Sales is calm. John lot of screenplays, which is how he makes like a lot of money, and then he finances his own movies. So he made one studio movie, and then he vowed to never make another movie. He has complete, when you pay for the movie yourself, you have complete control of the other movie. So he writes the films, and he directs the films, and you want to go for the right thing. You want to give him everything you can, but you're afraid to disappoint him. You know what I mean? That's a, you know, and you know, I did a movie with him in the Philippines. This tiny movie that had no money, with this amazing cast of people who were in the jungle, which was, but we all, you know, willingly went. We followed him into, to, you know, and he was one of the smartest humans I've ever met. He talked, you know, he went on, you know, 25 minutes why there was a band in the scene playing a song, why he had chosen that song. He explained the meaning and like why the chords, and it was like, we were like, this is, I mean, like, it was just unbelievable. Everything was so incredibly well thought out, you know. And, love him or hate him, the movies are from his brain, you know, very much so. And I always liked it.
Someone else, we're getting close.
Yeah, I got one.
Yeah.
Yes. I'm Kendrick, I'm one of the teachers in training here at Studio with Terry. I've been with him for nearly 10 years right now. My question to you is, mostly you have to do with of the set. How do you think your process has changed as an actor from the beginning to now? Because you mentioned something, the off times, the dips. There's a lot of in between. And sometimes when you get to a certain stage, you know, hopefully you'll get work after work after work. But in the beginning, sometimes there's a lot of
in between jobs.
Big gaps, yes.
Yeah.
And how has that changed for you in dealing with it?
You know, I mean, what happens is you think, I'm never going to work again. It's over, you know what I mean? You know, you try and find other things that, like I mentioned earlier, you know, photography is very, very important to me, and I love cameras. Mm-hmm. So I spend a lot of time, you know, photographing and stuff, and it just keeps me, you know, because the worst thing you can do is sit idle thinking about when is the next job, and you really make yourself insane. So you have to like find something else that, and it's amazing what happens when you do that, because that feeds, it all feeds itself. I mean, I go to work, there's things that I apply in my photography that I bring to work with me. You know? You know, and it's all about staying creative, at least for me, every day. You know, like I said, I play guitar all the time. I have a bunch of guitars in my house. So to me, it's, I would, if you remove that from me, if you took that away from me, I would probably just die, because the ship has sailed for me. You know what I mean? Like, I'm long in the tooth, man. I mean, so it's like, I don't know anything else, you know? You know, creating shit is all I ever really knew, you know what I mean? You know? I would say, stay, you know, creative. I mean, and create, like, I just formed this group with Michael back there and my buddy David, who we get together, and you can bring up to 10 pages, and it's actors and writers, and you get an email, and amazing people show up, you know. John Patrick Shanley came the other day and brought pages of a new play, you know what I mean? So, you know, I love doing that as well. I mean, like, I can't do enough of that, you know.
Thank
you. So, I mean, but you guys have everything here. You have, like, you can make stuff. You know, with the technology you have, actually, you have everything is in this room, you know?
I think you said there's a lot of fear on a movie set. I think there's a lot of fear in this room. Is that true?
Yes.
Yeah, because the big elephant is, what if I do all this training and then I don't work? Or right? And so I think part of Kendrick's question is also not just, it's about an attitude or a mindset.
Mm-hmm. Right?
It's not.
jump in, don't even look at to see if there's water. You know, because people are like, what's the plan B? I said, I never had a plan B, because I was like, a plan B is a safety valve out. It's like, there's no plan B. Like, the plan B would be, I'll go work at McDonald's. I don't know. It's like, I want to do this, and I will figure it out. You know, and you will figure it out. You know what I mean? And the universe is an incredible thing, because there'll be signposts. And if you look at, you'll see the signpost, you know what I mean? And you'll know, your life might take a turn. You know, mine took a turn, you know what I mean? If you told me I was going to be an actor, you know, when I was 20 years old, I would have told you you were nuts. Mm-hmm. So, dude, I play in a band. I fucking look at me. I didn't, but it's weird, because I always knew that I could act. I don't explain that to you. But I knew, and there was actors that I loved, and my grandmother worked for 30 years at the box office of a movie theater. So when I was a little kid, she was talking about all these people, and I didn't know who the fuck they were. And I'm like, all I knew was Jimmy Page, fucking Queen, Deep Purple, you know. That was like being Led Zeppelin. I didn't know from, you know, Montgomery Clift to Tyrone Power to any of them, none of these folks, which you guys are very young, so you probably don't know, but some of these great actors. So, you know, when my life turned, it was weird, there was a signpost. I was like, oh man, I can ignore the signpost, or I can like check it out. You know what I mean? And that's what you'll all do, you know. You're here because you want to do this well. I can't imagine you would be here if you didn't, you know. And that's worth a lot, man, you know, that you know. I remember sitting with Phil one time, we were watching something, there was a guy in it that wasn't very good. Phil turned to me and goes, he goes like, that guy's gonna have to figure out how to do this better. Mm-hmm. If he and I was like, oh my God, it's so simple. Yeah, he's gonna have to fit. Yeah, he's gonna do it so well. I mean, it's like, it's not gonna work out, you know what I mean? But you're here because you wanna do it well, you know? And you care about this.
And that gives you an edge, in my opinion. There's so many bad actors out there.
Horrible actors.
Right. Horrible. So many bad actors at work. Mm-hmm. And if your brand is doing it well, that's going to put you up there, would you say?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I go to work and I see people that I know have decided how they were going to do the scene 3 fucking weeks ago. And I'm like, dude, you're not here. Like, you're not in this room with me. You're like, I'm gonna do it like this, or whatever, you know, and then like, no, man. And that's not good work, you know what I mean? That's actually really bad work, but they're just not there, you know, and they're not open to the thing, and that's what this, it gave me was, it opened me to being present to things in my life that I hadn't been experiencing when I was still playing in a band, and that led me to the next experience and the next, and you know, 25 years later, but you know.
One more question. Yes, Aisha.
Hi, my name is Aisha, and I completed the tutor program today. I have a question about your current relationship to social media as like a public, you know, an actor in the public eye. Do you run your own accounts? Do you find someone to promote for you? And if you like, do your own Twitter, where do you find the balance between sharing like your personal opinions and keeping like a public profile?
My Twitter and Instagram accounts are me. There's a Facebook account that is not run by me, but they contact me with certain messages about, you know, like show up there, you know, I've had some relatives write to me on there, like my father had a second marriage. And I had like half brothers that lived in Cuba that like got on the deal. And I was like, I'm your half brother from it. I was like, it's crazy. But the social media thing is really, it's a great question. All these shows now, all these studios and all these networks have, you know, social media people. Like we had somebody that came out on the show every month, she would come out, and you are encouraged to stockpile material that you can launch, not now, but when the show begins to air. You know what I mean? And I know some actors are like, hey, social media, I'm not into it. So I'm like, you can be not into it, but again, that is real, and that ship has sailed too. You know, you can't turn the clock back. I mean, it's part of the thing now. You know what I mean? And it connects everyone. You know, and I actually love it because I love the tech of it. I love tech. I mean, and I love Instagram is a visual medium. You know what I mean? And you can communicate with pictures, which is how I love to. Sometimes I'll just send people an email with 7 or 10 pictures and no writing. Like, basically, that's just my state of mind now. That's my message to you, is these photographs. You know what I mean? So I actually love it. I mean, I love communicating with fans out there. I think it's great. You know, I think a guy can say, "Hey, dude, you know, I'm a guy from Cuba too. You know, I'm a guy that whatever. You know, and it's like a simple story to yours. You know, it's cool. And you know, I can write back to him and say, you know, go get him, brother. You know, I mean, it's like, you know, to me it's great. And I don't know, so it's not for everyone, but you know, like Sandy, never. I remember with the first iPad he had, he was like saying, you have to put your finger through it. He was trying to pierce the screen. It's like, you know, so I just got this. I'm like, but he's getting better. Right? He likes the iPhone too. Yeah, you know. Right, he used to have a flip phone for the longest time. Social media. I mean, look, man, we're like, this is like, you know,
crazy.
It's crazy, but it's amazing. You know, it's truly incredible.
Well, on that note, I want to thank you very much, Yul, for coming. And we can get started with that. Thank you all for coming.